So a friend recently asked me about calculating the miters for if you want to build a box like this, but you want to taper the sides out a little bit. What he realized is, because it didn't quite fit, is that the miter angles in here have to change a little bit. So I thought about this problem a fair bit, and I worked out the math for it, and I made a table for working out these angles using tons of trigonometry. And I even made a test piece on how to make one of these, and in this video I'll cover that a bit more. So to give you an idea why these angles need recalculating for different angles of tapering out this shape, so I've got this miter gauge set to 45 degrees, and that follows nicely along here, but now if I actually look on it along like this, you'll notice this is not the same angle anymore, because these things, as we move them out, they actually flatten out. And a good way to illustrate that is, imagine if we make just an octagon that is straight, and as we tilt these out further and further, imagine we tilt them all the way out until we just have a flat octagon. We don't actually have a beveled cut on here at all anymore. So the cut goes from a full 45 degrees for the joint, or 22 and a half on each side for an octagon, and as we splay it out completely by 90 degrees, it goes gradually to zero. But how far, how fast, and that's where a lot of trig comes in. So you can download that spreadsheet off my website, woodgears.ca, but gluing one of those shapes together is pretty tricky, so that's what I'll cover in this video. I had just cut the pieces off the end of a 2x4 with my miter saw, and the cool thing about that is you only need one setting, because when you cut the one piece off, you can just take your stock, flip it 180, and then make the next cut. But with everything in the miter saw being in such close quarters, I didn't feel that that was a very safe way of making the cuts. And I can never get a super clean cut on any sort of miter saw because there's just too much flex in the saw. So for this next one, I'm going to cut these on the table saw. So this time I want to make one that's 10-sided, and I want to tilt the sides out not by 30 like I did on this one, but by 40 degrees. So looking on here in this column for 10, and then 40 across for 40 degrees. The miter is 11.8, and the tilt of the saw is going to be 13.69. Now I also want the next one going to be a little bit larger than this one. This one is 27 across, and I think I want about 30 centimeters across for this one. And so that would mean the radius from the middle to the edge from here to here will be 15 centimeters, so I want an R of 15 centimeters, and looking over here, the R over L ratio here, that means I have to take 15 centimeters times 0.649, times 0.649, so I want my sides to be 9.7 centimeters long. So I need to set my miter to 11.8 degrees. Now this miter gauge has the right angle at 90 degrees, and I need to be 11.8 from 90. So it's just going from 90, 5, 10, and I need to go to almost 12, just shy of it. Now you may say, oh, these things aren't really trustworthy, but I've always second-guessed this miter gauge, and every time I set it precisely using other means, when I check this pointer, it always points at exactly the right number. Now I have to tilt the saw by 13.69 degrees. So 10, 11, 12, 13, and let's call that 0.69 here. If you'd like to second guess your angles, one of these rafter gauges is really good because they have a really large scale on here and they're one piece, so there's very little to go wrong with them. So let's check my 13.69 degree angle. So this would be 90 degrees here, and it's come in by 10, 11, 12, 13, and let's call that 0.69 here. And that's about as accurate as I can check it against this cheap little blade. I'm just going to add a sacrificial fence to the miter gauge because I want to be able to support the workpiece on both sides, so I'm going to cut through this fence. So I want all my pieces to be 9.74 centimeters long, so I've marked that here, and I've marked that same angle on here, and transferred the mark to the other side, so now that means I need to take this piece to about here, And I'm going to need all these pieces that same size so I can just clamp a stop to my fence so I can now just cut all these pieces one at a time. So next we need to glue these things together like that, but where to clamp them and how? So I figure it's easier to just glue them together in pairs, but I still have the question of how the heck do I clamp these? So I want to figure out the center of the area of the joint, so I'm just going to trace out the outline of my joint on the workbench. And here's basically the glue area, and I want the force to be applied right about this point with my clamps so that it's even along everything. So let's try to figure out how to project that down. So I'm going to use some pieces of wood, and let's get this piece of wood right over the corner, the center that I want to clamp. And let's put this piece of wood back on here, and I can tell the center of clamping should be right about this point here. So this is going to be tricky to clamp it just like that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to clamp some bits of wood to here. So if I clamp this piece of wood on here like so, then that center of clamping ends up here and I can have a place to put the clamp. Now you may wonder, for this scrap, I've got a bevel edge on here. What's the ideal angle for this? Well, the ideal angle is actually the same as this bevel down here, so it ends up parallel. So basically, I just use the saw with the tilt that I had set to it and cut these scraps out here. So let's put that on here with a C-clamp. Now it's still really tricky to clamp one of these together. If I used one of these quick grip clamps, that would certainly make it easier because I can operate that clamp one-handed. The problem is these clamps don't really apply a lot of force, so I don't like to use them for gluing. So this urban clamp works fairly well, because the ratchet tends to stay put. So if I just put that on here, and now, whoops. So to just force it together, and now tightening the screw, and I got it. So now to try this with glue. Okay, let's put these together. Now with glue, it's trickier because the glue is a lubricant. Up, and we can see glue squeezing out, so I hope I have enough glue in everything. So the thing I'm making has got 10 sides, and I've got 4 of these pairs already glued together, and I was about to glue the 5th one together when I realized that's a bad idea, because I want to be able to assemble these in halves, which means I need to add 1 extra segment to 2 pairs to get 2 pieces of 5. I just unclamped all of my pairs, and 2 of those pairs I used the same method to glue another segment on there. So now I just need to glue the segment of 2 to a segment of 3. And as usual, this is tricky. So now I just need to put those 2 segments of 5 together to get a bowl shape. Unfortunately, it's not that simple because these joints don't quite close. With 20 miter cuts all around, the errors accumulate, and even if I'm only a fraction of a degree off, by the time I get to the last miter, that's 10 times as much. So the best way to fix that is to flatten the 2 joints on the belt sander. So with these sanded into one plane on both parts, they now fit together pretty good, and I'm ready to start clamping. This is, of course, frustrating as always.
Well, got it aligned at last.
So here's my finished shape. I'm not sure what I'm going to do with it. Maybe try to turn a bowl out of it.